had Peter and Klaus here for the week at PCP doing their thing. You got me. Tonight's just a chance, I guess a lot of you haven't been able to get to the cafe because we all work the same hours as the place is open. So we wanted to give the people a chance to know these guys and follow their work and are interested in hearing a little bit from them. Just a chance to say good day. And rather than just mingle around, which is good, we wanted to give them a chance to just let you know what they've been up to this week, why they came. But if you have any questions about anything, maybe keep it coffee related.
Whatever.
Yeah. Whatever. Okay. All right. Get a chair. This could go on all night. So that's what this is going to be about. I'll start off by asking, what are you doing here? How did you end up in Sydney?
What the hell are we doing here? Yeah. So
where did it start?
Well, this is a good question. I think I first got the email from Mark. Is he hiding something?
This
is Mark. Okay. Good.
So we can talk about it.
I just got an invite from him to come here. It was actually just after Mainz in Belgium, the whole WBC Christmas, and we were just emailing because we didn't have a chance to talk during that whole thing. Like, I think a lot of you have heard, had like a similar experience that week was just crazy. Nodding heads, yeah. So, then we were just saying that we should get a chance to catch up either at Origin or something else. And, that's when he sort of told me the idea about this place and how it's really, you know, trying to not be about, this sounds weird to say, like my logo and everything is everywhere, but it's not about a roaster. It's about all the roasteries. It's about creating a platform where it's like, we can bring in different coffees from any place in the world. Local roasters and international roasters and, you know, just the fact that they can get coffees from Denmark to here, like, it's pretty astonishing. Like, just talking to you about the difficulties getting coffee to Canada if you wanted that. So it takes a lot of willpower to do that. And so he was also explaining like part of the project here is buying green coffee and sending it to different roasteries and getting their interpretation of both filter and espresso roast, and then presenting it on bar, and that the whole idea is to sort of not do it as an industry thing, not just having like cuppings where we're weeking out, but actually doing it in a commercial environment where people can come in off the street and taste something different than they're used to. I think there's a lot of people just slump into the habit of going to the same coffee shop all the time, tasting the same coffees. So it's sort of trying to get people to experience something else. So he told me all that in like very short, and then invited us to come out. And this is Peter's first trip to Australia, so yeah. So it was a good chance for you to come here as well.
So what coffees did you bring?
Everything except.
Why did you bring them?
Most of our menu.
Why did you bring them?
Well, I guess we wanted to show how we work. Both that our menu is not that broad. Yeah. Only 6-7 coffees in our menu, that's all. But still, I think flavor-wise, I hope you all got a chance to taste them. But they are quite different flavor-wise, so we cover a little broader in terms of flavor and in terms of number. And that's what we would like to show.
Yeah, I mean, for us it's not about, like, I know probably a lot of people have seen pictures of like the world map in one of our shops is like covering the back wall. But it's really not about having a range of coffees that just put pins in a world map. You couldn't care less where, like, what countries they're from. But it's more thinking like from covering a lot, you sort of have an idea what kind of coffee flavors are actually out there. And then sort of like mapping that in. So you have something that's like crazy acidic and something that's low in acidity. And you have something that's really balanced and something that's just aromatic. So trying to like create a menu of coffee that will attract all these different flavors or attract people who like the different flavors. So for us it's not just doing light roasted acidic coffees. Like that, some of our coffees like that, but we also like to have something that's really balanced. We didn't bring our two single origin espressos, but one of them, the Datera Sweet Collection from Brazil, is we actually sell a lot of that as filter coffee in Denmark. It's for us, it's a quite dark filter roast. It's still a very light espresso roast. I mean, light espresso roast. It's like compared to something. It's like, yeah, just. So what is it, beginning, second?
Just the beginning, second.
Yeah. And but we have a lot of people who really love that for filter because it's really full body, it's really low acidity, and you know, go for it if they like it. We're not going to judge. We'd probably rather push it in some other direction, but we have to present it. Yeah.
I think what we wanted to show was also exactly this filter thing, because that's what we feel is one of the big differences from. Yeah. We do normally, and what's going on here, it seems like 90% of the coffee you serve, more or less, tell me if I'm wrong, it's espresso based. 95% anyone higher. but in our place, we are 50-60% espresso based, and the rest will be filter roast. So that's also what we thought would be interesting to show the range of filter roast that we have here and focus on that.
When Casper and I was here half a year ago, we talked to a lot of roasters, and there seemed to be, I don't know if you can agree to this, there seemed to be a lot of them saying, like, they wish they would serve more filter. Like, it's sort of like all the baristas, they were really getting into pour over, manual pour over, and serving filter, and it seems like that's what they were into, so obviously that's what they wanted to serve as well. And they were sort of struggling that people weren't really buying into it. And I think, I mean, I don't know exactly what, like, if there's like one model to get people to buy into it, but at least it's worked this week. Like, you've sold quite a lot more filters than regularly, and probably, like, from what I've seen around, more hand brew filters than most shops around.
Top 2
people. Yeah.
For us.
Yeah.
One person is by far.
Yeah.
Can you see a reason behind that? Is it just because it's something different? You guys from Denmark, or is it? A range of options
I think it's both the way it's presented here, that when you come in, like I noticed the first day when I came in that my eyes were immediately drawn to this bar sooner than the espresso bar. So I think there's a lot in like in shop layout, we can, if that's our mission, we want to push it, which we have to decide for us, it's in the culture, then designing a bar layout that emphasizes that this is important to us and this is accessible. I think that's part of the reason it's a success here. And then of course that it's been communicated really, really strongly that hey, this week come and have some filter, this, you know, some lines have floating from Denmark and they're excited to present whatever they're doing. And, you know, I think that attracts people to it. And the menu as well. Like that the menu you're presented with has really like sort of an emphasis on that. And that's something we've seen in our third shop, that the thing you're presented with there is a menu that on page one, right in the front, lists the different black coffee options that we have. And they're, the way we've done it is that we've listed them, like, the only thing that you really have to decide is what would you like to taste. So it's flavor descriptors. And I know this is back and forth with like flavor descriptors and on bags and everything that, you know, I see the point that it's when we tell someone this is what you're gonna experience, they already sort of locked into that. At the same time, I think it's a pity if people just choose their black coffee from brew method or a country or something that really doesn't matter. Like brew method should not be something the guests have to concern themselves with. That should be on our end, really. So we listed it by flavor, and we're selling in that shop, like, because it's on page one, and then you have to get to page three or four on the menu until all the regular espresso based drinks are there. Because of that, we're selling much more filter hand brew there. It's more than 50% of the sales in that shop is the hand brewed filter options. And when I say hand brew filter, it's just to clear that up, it's we brew on Kaliza Wave, on AeroPress, on S-Pro. It's a French press that's microfiltered, and sometimes on V60 as well. So, yeah.
We have one more thing we work with to try and sell more of our filtered coffee, and that's that we have table service. I guess that's quite common here. But in Denmark, the normal thing in a coffee shop would be that you are ordering and getting your coffee at the bar, and there'll be a line, and the normal Danish consumer is kind of that polite, or I don't know, that they don't want to delay the person behind them if they're standing in line. So they just make the fast decision on the cafe latte, and then they get the cafe latte and walk on.
Yeah.
But in our third shop, we'll ask people to take a seat at the table, and then we'll come back down to them, show them where the menu will be on the table already, but show them that you're just standing and waiting for them, and you're ready to talk to them, and not stressed. There's no one else in line. You can decide on what you really would like, not just your first reaction on the cafe latte.
Yeah.
That's also one of the things we wanted to push our brewers.
Yeah.
Is there a reason why you offer multiple brewing options when you're trying to showcase the flavors?
The way it's done is that we thought about it when we opened the third shop, that it would be nice for the barista group to just have a bunch of brew methods available. And depending on which coffee it is and how it performs on brew method, they can choose like what would they brew on for this particular coffee. So it said like when we do the menu that we change around, it said like, okay, now we're gonna have like for the next month, we're gonna have Finkenstein Mortar on Espro Press, because we really think we want to push the body this time.
But so you can hone in on that one coffee, on that one brew method.
Yeah,
exactly. Showcase that as a beverage rather than a brew method or coffee, and it's a nice experience.
Yeah,
with much better words than that.
Yeah, that's exactly it. Yeah.
How hard is it as a business to do that every day, to hone in on what each coffee tastes like on each different brew method?
Honestly, I don't think it's all that hard once you dial in. And if you have a good grinder that's not like flicking all over the place, then the colitas are really stable. The AeroPress and the Espro are extremely stable with the way we brew them, where it's full immersion. We do the inverted method, 1 minute steep time on the AeroPress, which really makes it really stable. The V60s we've had, like, that's more fragile to dialing in. So we use V60s less and less, to be honest, but and more and more Kalita. But it depends. Sometimes the barista group will think, you know, this coffee just like gets some more florals or something that's more delicate out on a V60, and they'll decide to use the V60 for that, and they just have to work on dialing it in.
What have you guys got out of your time here at Paramount? Like, obviously we've been able to taste all of your amazing coffees and talk with you about different things, but what have you kind of got out of spending time with the Australian?
I think we have a lot that we need to go home and consume and think about. But it's definitely very inspiring. I was talking to a few guys here about it. I think that often in our part of the world, right now Scandinavia, we have a pretty good thing going on, but we have been looking a lot to the States and what's been going on there. But in a way, I feel that maybe we can learn more from here, because even though the cultures were different, it's still closer, I feel, to our Northern European culture than the culture in the States. So in that way, I think we have something to learn, and what we in particular are inspired about is how that you can have kitchens and good coffee. You don't see that in Denmark. You'll have kitchens and alcohol, or you will have good coffee.
Yeah.
And it's quite inspiring, because most people like both good food and good coffee. So
yeah,
that's one of the things. At least.
That is really one of the things we noticed half a year ago when we were here last time as well, that like the good coffee places did amazing food as well. It's something we don't see in our part of the world. Then I think also it's been really fun, like just very sort of low practical things, but getting on bar in a bar that's different than what you're used to, but that's set up great, you know, where you have good equipment and everything, and then like getting the chance to dial in, see how other people dial in, is really interesting. I think that for me has been one of the highlights of the week, and see that within like 3 days the guys here were able to dial in our Macchia'tho better than I was able to dial in. That's pretty great to see.
Was there a big difference then? Like when you saw people dialing in here like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, were you like freaking out, or was it?
No, I mean not freaking out. I think I actually felt very sort of comfortable with it. Like the sheets that you guys have for dialing in, where you lock everything and then you can go back. So it means like if I want to come over and do one, I can go look at the sheet, look up, you know, water in, water or brew out, you know, with dose, grind setting, TDS, extraction yield, and flavor descriptors. So I can basically go over and I can start on that, and I'll have a probably 95% chance of making something that's really delicious instead of just winging it, hopefully at least. But also on espresso, I mean, it's one of those things where we had a good talk on espresso the first couple of days on like what we were getting out. We actually didn't do the exact brew recipe that we do back home, but we did the same brew ratio and got the same flavor out of it. And it's then Peter started changing water, and then you know, it's like everything got for grabs. But I really think it's funny to see, like, if you have good water, you have good equipment. Like, a lot of this equipment is the same that we used to back home. Then we were talking about, we actually think we made our coffee here taste more like our own shops than a lot of our wholesale customers actually capable of doing. Because they buy different equipment, or the water in Copenhagen, it's literally shit. So
literally?
It's literally shit.
Not bad. It's literally. Yeah.
It's pretty disgusting, but let's clean it out. So, yeah.
The sewage is coming to your espresso.
Yeah, basically, yeah.
I think maybe also this kind of, I have the feeling that it's a bit more mature barista culture here than in Denmark. In Denmark, it seems like it's very, we are a handful of places that are taking the barista training and position and everything serious. But it's still very few who think that they can work for a long time in this industry.
Yeah.
In Denmark, it seems like it's a bit more mature culture in that way. Yeah.
It's one of the big differences in that in Denmark, like, we're literally, as far as I know, the first roastery and coffee shops, even coffee shop, we just say that, that's been opened by baristas. Like, people who actually have long work experience behind bar in Denmark. Like, most of what you see in Denmark is just business owners. People who have money and they go and open up a cafe because they think it's good business. They get wiser, but it's, you know, that's just the deal. And so, like, down here, a lot of the places that have opened up in the past many years have been people who gained experiences from other coffee shops or other roasteries. So we're still sort of waiting for that next level to happen, but I think it's coming, like, the next 5-10 years. Definitely there'll be a lot of baristas starting up, I'm sure.